Now that we discussed the many details of our immune system, let's actually connect the dots. Let's describe how the innate immune system interacts with the adaptive immune system and how they work together to actually carry out the function of protecting and defending our healthy cells of the body from different types of pathogenic infections. And let's begin by imagining the following scenario. Let's suppose we have the surface of our skin as shown in the diagram. Then we have the skin tissue, and below that we have our blood vessel that carries our blood plasma from this side to this side of our diagram. Now, let's imagine that we have some type of cut that is formed on the surface of our skin as shown in this diagram. And let's imagine that in close proximity to our cut, we have some type of pathogen. Now, the pathogen could be some type of parasite, it could be some type of viral agent, it could be some type of bacterial cell, or it could be a simple allergen. In either way, once our pathogen makes its way into our skin tissue, our immune system will elicit some type of defensive response. And this is what we're going to focus on in this lecture. So let's suppose our pathogen invades our skin tissue. What will happen next? Well, the first thing that will happen is a cell called a mast cell and a cell called a dendritic cell will react to the antigens that are produced by that pathogen. So the pathogen will begin producing an antigen, and let's assume the antigen is some type of pathogenic peptide. So that is shown by these red dots. So let's begin with the mast cells. So mast cells on their surface contain these receptors, and these receptors can bind antigens non-specifically. And what that basically means is it doesn't matter what type of antigen is found in close proximity, these mast cells will bind any antigen. And once they bind that antigen, they know that there is some type of pathogen in close proximity. And so what they begin to do is they remain within the tissue and they begin releasing chemicals. So what types of chemicals? Well, they release histamines. And histamines, when they move into our blood, they dilate the blood vessel, and that increases the flow of blood to this infected area. And that in turn, as we'll see in just a moment, brings more of the white blood cells that basically help protect this area. Now, the other chemical that they release is heparin. And heparin is basically an anticoagulant. And what that means is it decreases the blood clotting capability of our blood, and that makes the blood more leaky. It also increases the flow of blood to this area. On top of that, these chemicals also make the capillaries more leaky, and that means more blood can actually get into the tissue, and that means more of these white blood cells can end up in the tissue that is infected by this pathogen. So these chemicals essentially initiate the process of inflammation that takes place in the innate immune system. Now, these also release cytokines, and the cytokines essentially call upon other cells, for example, macrophages, neutrophils, and other cells, as we'll discuss in just a moment. Now, let's move on to this other cell found within the tissue known as our dendritic cell. Now, dendritic cells are also capable of taking these antigens, but they engulf those antigens into that cell. Inside the cell, they can digest or break down those antigens into smaller antigens, and they take a small portion of the antigen known as an epitope, and they place it on a special membrane known as the major histocompatibility complex that is found on that membrane. So once these antigens shown in red are on the membrane protein, what the dendritic cell does is it actually exits. It leaves the tissue, enters our blood system, and it moves to the lymph nodes of our body. And this is the cell that calls upon our adaptive immune system, as we'll see in just a moment. This cell is also capable of binding any antigen non-specifically, but it takes that antigen and it brings it to the adaptive immune system. And we'll see exactly what the interaction is in just a moment. So it's the dendritic cell that connects the innate immune system to our adaptive immune system of our body. Now, let's move on to the cells that are found in the blood that are called upon by these chemicals released into our blood in the first place by the mast cell and by other cells of our body. So let's begin with a group of cells known as granulocytes. And these granulocytes are called granulocytes because they have granules, they have tiny vesicles that contain chemicals within the cytoplasm. So we have neutrophils, we have basophils, and we have eosinophils, and all these cells are found within the blood, and they respond to these chemicals released into the blood, and then they move into the skin tissue where our infection is taking place. Now, let's begin with neutrophils. Neutrophils are phagocytic cells, and what that means is when they move into our skin tissue, they begin to engulf these pathogens. So these pathogens, once again, could be bacterial cells, they can be some type of viral agent, in which case these viruses will infect our cells, and what these neutrophils can do is actually engulf those cells that have been infected by our virus. Now, what about basophils? Well, basophils and eosinophils are found in high concentration if the invading pathogen is some type of allergen or some type of parasite. So these respond to infections due to parasite or allergic reactions. They move from the blood and into our tissue and also release histamine and heparin, just like the mast cell. And that, once again, dilates our blood vessel, makes our capillaries more leaky so that there is a higher flow of fluid into our tissue, and it also decreases the ability of our blood to actually clot itself, and that increases the flow of our blood as a result. So these eosinophils also are found in high concentration when we have some type of allergic reaction, if this pathogen is an allergen or if it is some type of parasite. Now, another type of innate immune cell is the natural killer cell. Now, these natural killer cells, as shown in the following diagram, basically have a special receptor on that cell. And these receptors can bind onto either infected cells that have been infected with some type of viral agent, or they can bind onto cancer cells and destroy those cancer cells. So these natural killer cells circulate inside our blood, and they respond to these cytokines released by the mast cell and other cells, and they move into that infected area from the blood into the tissue. So these natural killer cells circulate in the blood and moves into affected tissue. They bind onto cancer cells or infected cells, and once they bind, they release powerful digestive enzymes that drill holes in that infected cell or cancer cell, and that lyses our cell. Now, once the cell lyses, we have these macrophages that are also called upon by these cytokines released into our blood as a result of that mast cell and other cells. Now, these macrophages are the largest type of phagocytic cell in our body. They basically move from the blood into our tissue, and they begin engulfing anything that is harmful or pathogenic to the healthy cells of our body. And that includes the lysed cell that was lysed by the natural killer cell, or any infected cell, or any pathogen found inside our tissue. So macrophages are large phagocytic cells that engulf pathogens, infected cells, cancer cells, and any debris that is found within a tissue that might be harmful to the cells of that tissue. So these move from the blood and into our tissue. So these seven cells we just described are the major seven cells that are non-specific and which are part of the innate immune system. Two of these cells are usually found within our skin tissue. We have the mast cell and the dendritic cell, but it's the dendritic cell that moves into our blood and carries the antigens into the adaptive immune system of our body, the white blood cells found in our lymph nodes and in our lymph system. So let's move on to our adaptive immune system. So we have two types of cells. We have B lymphocytes or B cells, and we have T lymphocytes or T cells. So once our dendritic cell brings those antigens to these cells, this is what begins to take place. If our antigen-presenting cell, this dendritic cell, interacts with B lymphocytes, those B lymphocytes, with the help of another cell known as a helper T cell, will differentiate into plasma cells or memory B cells. And it's the plasma cells that will begin to produce antibodies specific to these antigens that are brought to these B lymphocytes by our dendritic cell and other cells such as our macrophage. So basically, our plasma cells produce these antibodies that are released into our blood system, and then these antibodies can bind to these specific antigens, and once they bind onto the antigens, they label them for destruction by cells like macrophages, neutrophils, and other cells of our body. Now, memory cells are those cells of our body that remain with us for the duration of our lifetime, and they keep a copy of this antigen in case reinfection ever takes place. And if reinfection does take place, they elicit a secondary immune response that is much quicker and more efficient than a primary immune response. Now, what about the T lymphocytes? So this dendritic cell can also interact with T lymphocytes. There are four different types of T lymphocytes. We have helper T cells, cytotoxic T cells, suppressor T cells, and memory T cells. So helper T cells are a very important type of lymphocyte because they assist many other cells with the differentiation process. Helper T cells help B lymphocytes differentiate into plasma cells and memory B cells, and they also help T lymphocytes themselves differentiate into cytotoxic T cells. So helper T cells assist with B and T cell differentiation, and these also release their own cytokines and interleukins, different chemicals that essentially call upon cells like macrophages to that specific area. Now, cytotoxic T cells are like natural T cells because these basically attack infected cells, cells that have been infected by a viral agent, or they can also attack cancer cells. But there is an important difference. Cytotoxic T cells are specific, and what that means is they will only bind to a specific antigen. While natural killer cells are non-specific, it doesn't matter what type of antigen is found on that pathogenic cell, this will bind to it, but this only binds to a specific cell, and that's because this dendritic cell brought a specific type of antigen to this cytotoxic T cell, so it will only react to this specific antigen that was brought to it. Now, finally, we also have suppressor T cells and memory T cells. Memory T cells are like memory B cells. They essentially help us with reinfection. They keep a copy of our antibody, while suppressor T cells help us regulate the different types of white blood cells in our body, and they use a negative feedback mechanism to tone down or turn down our immune response. So we see that the innate immune immune system does in fact interact with the adaptive immune system. Even though this is the first one to actually react to our infection, we have special cells like our dendritic cells and macrophages that basically are antigen-presenting cells. They present antigens on the surface of their membrane and they move to our adaptive system, to our lymph nodes, and they basically cause the differentiation of B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes, which then use a specific mechanism to attack specific antigens and specific pathogens found in our body.